work Ernest Tate. Now, suppose you was in the Army right now. Not being one to follow rules, you'd be in and out of trouble the whole time you was in there.
I wasn't fixing on going to no Army.
What?
No, I'm just going to get me my uniform, go on home and stay.
Let me get this clear in my mind.
Huh?
You mean all you want is a uniform?
Is all.
Well, what for?
Girls. And love. You know what is the truth, Sheriff? As clever and as good-looking as I am, I just can't get a girl.
You can't, huh?
Oh, there's three or four girls back up in the mountains. Would be mine if I had a uniform. But you ought to see him flit around old Jelsick Sturm when he come back home with his uniform. Jelsick, walk with me. Jelsick, dance with me. Jelsick, kiss my mouth.
Girls. That's why you want a uniform.
Yeah, I could have been hitched by now if I don't had one. I got everything else but. I got looks, brains, personality. I kiss good. The only thing standing twixt me and sweet romance is uniform.
Wonder where we can find a small-sized uniform.
No, Andy. Listen, I had this made in Raleigh. This is genuine whiplash cord. Andy?
Much obliged, Sheriff.
You're more than welcome, Ernest Tate. There goes a happy man.
There goes a happy nut.
The year was, I believe, 2000, 2001. My wife and I, we were visiting her folks, her family in Atlanta, Georgia, and we'd gone to a church up in Alpharetta, which is right on north of Atlanta. And out of Atlanta, there's this little hardware store you might have heard of that comes out of there called Home Depot. And we're driving by, and we see this Home Depot Expo. And we said, well, you know, wonder if we can buy some screws and hammers and whatever nails that we need to get there. And we went in, and not nary one screw or nail or hammer for sale, because we didn't know what a Home Depot Expo was. But I'm telling you, going to tell you what a Home Depot Expo was, because it no longer is, because in 2009 or 2010, they shut down all the Home Depot Expos. You go into this Home Depot Expo, and it's like, kind of like Rooms to Go. It's like bathrooms and kitchens. And so it's like being in a huge warehouse, and they've got these bathrooms and these kitchens, and they're kind of like put together. Here's what your bathroom can look like. And here's what your bathroom can look like. And here's what your kitchen could look like. It's kind of like an envy thing. You know, you go around, ooh, oh, this is nice. But there was one thing that was a little odd in going there, and I finally asked a person about it. They had these signs for display only. And these were very prominent signs written for display only. And I thought, you know, I figured it was for display only. But you only got to tell me once. But like at every single, I mean, we're talking gobs and gobs of bathrooms and gobs of kitchen. You know what? You know, it was like the face of the microwave. It wasn't the actual microwave on some of them. It was like, you know, they would have fruit in there, but it wasn't like a real apple. It was fake because it was for display only. And I asked a person, I said, why do y'all have all these display-only signs? They said, that's for the parents. And I'm thinking, okay, I want to hear it because I'm a parent. And I said, what about it? Well, we've had some parents that were not quite as attentive to their children as they probably should be. And so when a kid's got to go, a kid's got to go. And these commodes don't lead to anywhere. And the parents don't seem to have a problem with the kid making a mess, but they don't want to suffer the consequences, the after effects, because there's no flusher on this thing. Now, to a kid of 5 or 6 years old, you're sitting there and you say, you know, that's probably an honest mistake. You better put there, you know, warning for display only. More to the point, as a parent, you ought to keep control of your kid and make sure they're not exploring the different things in Home Depot Expo. I said, does that happen a lot? He says, you would not believe how often that happens. But it's for display only. And I get the title for my sermon from that experience, For Display Only. We are in the most famous sermon ever preached. For the last 2,000 years, preachers have studied this sermon. It's the sermon that Jesus preached in Matthew chapter 7 that we covered 3 weeks ago, or no, 4 weeks ago now. We had the end of the sermon. And the end of a sermon was an illustration. It was, Jesus said, a person who listens to my words and puts them to work in their lives is like a man that goes out and builds a house on a rock and on a firm foundation. But a person who hears my words, knows the instructions I'm giving, but doesn't put it into practice, he's like a man that went out and built his home on a sand, on a foundation that would be swept away. And when a storm came, it hit both houses. And the one who put my words into effect, the one who heeded my lessons and integrated them into his life, that person was able to stand the storm. And he said that at the end of his sermon, when he closed it out, people said he spoke differently from the religious leaders they were accustomed to, because he spoke as one having authority. And we said these were people who were pressed in on the one side by religious people, religious leaders, who would want to manipulate them and tell them every move to make. And on the other side, political leaders that wanted to just keep the pressure on them, to manipulate them and make sure that all of their effort and all of their work and all of the things they did was for their benefit and not for the people working benefit. That's why our founding fathers put in there to be able to pursue happiness. See, some people think it's a tax issue. It's a human dignity issue. That you get to keep and have a large portion of that which you work for. And neither the religious nor the political should squeeze you out. And these people were desperate. They were famished. When they would look to the religious leaders for answers, for nourishment, they saw something completely different that didn't fill their hearts and didn't fit the need that they had. When they looked to politics and the political leaders back then, all they saw was war and capture and dominance. And to be put under that thumb. We looked at 3 weeks ago, we looked at the fact that Jesus said, when you feel like you're at your worst, those things that you see in your life that you think are deficiencies, he says, boy, you're in for a big surprise. And we looked at those Beatitudes. I showed you where that took place and how Jesus spoke life into those people. And he encouraged them with his words. And so we looked at the beginning of this and we looked at the end of this sermon. And this morning we're going to look at the middle. Because most of the actions, most of the things we do because we've seen somebody else do them. And in the Sermon on the Mount, we have a religious teacher, a rabbi, telling people how to connect with God. And he's telling them in a way that they'd never heard before, that they'd never understood before. Because up to this point, it had been all about display, and it was for display only. And there was something that was really missing. And you find out that the religious leaders of that day, they were more interested in feeding their egos than they were in feeding the flock. They were more interested in keeping power than they were in encouraging people to be empowered and to know the God who loved them and who had created them. So when it comes to religious things, Jesus will speak in the passage we're going to cover this morning of three different practices that religious people do. And he's going to turn those practices on their heads. He's going to tell them that, you know, there's a reason why this stuff feels weird and feels wrong, because it is the way you've seen it practiced. So in Matthew chapter 6, in verse 1, he says, be careful. Be careful. Watch out. I'm giving you a warning. And in each of these things he's going to talk about, he gives them a warning. He gives them some instructions. He gives them a guarantee. And he gives them an encouragement or instruction on what they need to do. And he starts off in this first verse by kind of encapsulating or overview of the whole thing he's going to talk about. He says, be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others in order to be seen by them. The practice of righteousness. You know, the practice of righteousness. It's funny how some people could say, oh, they're practicing righteousness. And I can remember we were in our church in Dallas that we attended, and we had some people visit the church, and that night, Sunday night, we were eating together, some other friends of ours in the church, and they said, did you notice we had visitors this morning? This was a large church. Every Sunday we had visitors. I mean, this was a church of somewhere around 700 or so. And, you know, did you notice visitors? Well, yeah, sort of, kind of visitors. And I said, oh, they were so spiritual. Wait a minute. Jim, how did you know they were so spiritual? Because when they sang, they closed their eyes and they lifted their hands, and you know. Now, I'm not telling y'all to look over here, but there's sometimes I get into the music and I do that. But the way you tell a person is spiritual is not by what they do with their hands and with their eyes. And we have become conditioned as a people to say, spiritual people act this way, spiritual people do this. And what Jesus is saying is, be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others in order to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. Well, what's the purpose of practicing your righteousness? What's the purpose of growing and using those muscles that God is giving you in a spiritual sense? It's so you can grow close to your Father in heaven. But if you do it for the wrong reason, then he says, you're not going to be working towards that goal. You're going to be working towards a different goal. And he says there's three areas. One is in the area of giving. The other is in the area of praying. And the other is in the area of fasting. And these three areas he's going to deal with. Because the only models they ever had were bad models. And they're wanting to know, what can we do to please God? What can we do to connect with God? What can we do to make sure that God is real and relevant in our lives and that we love Him and that we know Him? What can we do that is not for display only? And he says, I want to teach you a lesson by telling you what not to do. And he says, you see all these guys over here in funny hats? You see all the guys over here in funny collars? You see all those people that look different than you? And the reason they're looking different than you is because they want to tell everyone that they are more spiritual than you are. He said, I want to tell you about them. Those are not your models. So he will start off. First, he talks about giving. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Now, I don't think he's talking about literal trumpets. But I'm saying, what I think he's saying is that when you give, in other words, he's anticipating you are going to give to needs. Now think about the flip side of that. If you're giving to the need of another, what is the implication of that? That you have an abundance. That God has blessed you with an abundance. God has blessed you with enough to share. It's like, you know, me and my brother. We had to quickly learn about how to share things. Because, you know, if it was up to me, y'all share it. I'd take a cookie that big and I'd break off a little piece like that and say, this is your part. And we quickly learned that Solomon's wisdom. One cuts and the other one chooses. So which do you want to do? And that would keep everybody on the same page. Well, when you give, by the very act of giving, you are giving testimony to the fact that the God of heaven has blessed you with more than enough. You have enough to share. He says, but when you do this, don't make a big deal out of it. Don't go announce, hey, everybody, I'm giving. Did you see Magnum this week? We saw it last night, Magnum this week. Well, one of the guys, when the scene happened, I said, man, I could use that for my video clip this week. There's a guy that got into an honest business. Now, Gail and I are not that creative to do this, but he had got into the business of laundering money. Not what you think. Literally laundering money. In this age of COVID, your money is dirty and it needs to be laundered. And he would take people's money and he would go wash it at the laundromat and have it real nice for them, and they would give him money for cleaning their money. And he had made $1,000 doing that. And by doing that, he was saying, what am I going to buy now? Because he never had any money. What am I going to buy now? And he had met a lady in the laundromat who was caring for her grandchild because her daughter was addicted to drugs and couldn't care for the grandchild. And the reason she was in the laundromat is because her washer and dryer had broke. And it was a lady who had worked hard, and it was a lady who every time she turned around, somebody or something was happening to take her out at the knees. And he was sitting there, what do I want to do with this $900 and some I have? What do I want to buy me? And all of a sudden he thought about her. And it was the craziest thing. He knocked on the door and he gave her the money. And she couldn't believe it. Sounds good. The problem was he would have been better off if he would have read verse 2 of what Jesus is talking about here. Because when he gets back to the bar where Magnum and them are, I just gave somebody a lot of money. I just did something that is not like me, that's uncharacteristic of me. He announced it. Jesus is saying here, don't follow what the religious leaders that put themselves up to be your leaders do, because when they give, they make sure that everybody knows. Full page ads, billboards, flashing signs. It's posted on Facebook, everywhere else that they have given. He said, don't do this, because here's their motive for doing it. Their motive is to be honored by others. They want others to go, oh man, they are special. They are, dare we say, religious. They are big time. And he tells us why that's the problem in verse 3. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. That term, in full, there was a term they've discovered in archaeology for commerce, trading and commerce. And it meant, it was like the receipt when you'd received your payment in full. Person would write a receipt. Okay, this is all you are owed. You're getting no more. The payment is in full. There's nothing else to expect from this transaction. This is it. And Jesus says, when they do this, when they announce so they can be honored by others, they've received their payment in full. Don't expect anything else. And he says, but, when you give to the needy, talking to the people that are sitting there listening to him, people that are pushed between religious and the politicians, he said, when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then, here's what happens. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. I used to love the Candid camera, the old Candid camera, black and white Candid camera. And they did experiment with some kids. I think they've redone that with the newer one that no longer on the air. Home Depot Expo is gone. Candy Camera is gone. But they did an experience to where a kid would sit there and they would say, okay, if you can just wait and not eat this cookie and wait, then you'll get something later. And they were showing all the ways the kids would get close to it and everything, but how they would wait for that reward. When you give to the needy, if you make sure that it's okay with you, if the only person that knows this is God, the fact that God knows it, God will reward you. This was a promise that Jesus gave. So you have to ask yourself, for some people, being honored by others publicly is worth a lot more than being rewarded by God privately. He goes on and he says, when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. And he's talking again about the religious people, the guys with the hats, the guys with all the gear, the religious gear. Do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on street corners to be seen by others. It matters to them where they pray, because where they pray is where the people are. Well, what drives them to practice their righteousness of praying is not wanting to connect with a holy God that loves them, but it's to pray in front of others, to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. That's it. When they pray in front of other people, the adulation, the excitement they get from looking out and seeing those people go, oh, that's enough. Paid in full. Don't expect anything else from that. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in the secret place will reward you. Now, but there are other people that pray, right? I mean, there was a lot of praying going on last night. Somebody texted me who won a little basketball game. I can't even tell you where the game was played. But anyway, there were people praying. So maybe, let's don't look to the religious people. Let's look to what other people are praying. And he'll address that. He says, next one. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans. Don't, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. You've seen this kind of prayer when you're in food line or in Walmart and you're going up that cart and you have like a 3 or 4 year old kid. Mama, can I have this? Mama, can I have this? Mama, can I have this? Can I have this, Mama? Can I have this? Can I have this, Mama? And the whole thing, if I just keep going, I'm just going to wear her down. I'm going to wear him down. That's the way they do. He said that's not the example you follow either. He says, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need even before you ask Him. Can you believe God is that smart? God knows before you ask Him. He knows things that you don't know. And He knows things there that you are going to know that He already knows. And it's important that when you learn those things, that you run to Him. Because to run to anybody else to run to any other place for any other reason stunts you and does not allow you to develop into the person He wants you to be. And then He goes on, He says, this then is how you should pray. He's not saying this is what to pray. This He's saying how to pray. Not what to pray. Some people go, you know, yeah, I pray, and I pray this prayer. And they call it the Lord's Prayer. This is the disciples' prayer. The Lord's Prayer is in the book of John. This is the disciples telling Him how you to pray. And He's going to mention three things here. And we could do a whole sermon. In fact, I've done a whole series on this prayer. But before we go there, I just want to tell you what you're going to see. You're going to see that the way we should pray is we should recognize the nature of God and who He is. We should recognize the nature of ourselves and who we are. And we should recognize the chasm or the need that separates us. And right there is where we should drill in our praying. Here's what He says. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. He says, think of that. You are connecting with your Father. You are going to know your Father. How would you know Him except by spending time with Him? Except by talking to Him? Except by letting Him know what's on your heart? Not so He will learn something, but so you can become something, can grow and act like His kid. He says, your kingdom come. That's His program. God has a program. We talked about this in the summer, God's program, God's kingdom program, and how He's trying to invade this earth, this space, with His program of goodness and righteousness and helpfulness. He's trying to bring that in. And whenever we sense tension in our lives, there's this tension between these two programs, His kingdom and our kingdom, or the world's kingdom. And these kingdoms are in conflict. He says, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What God wants to have happen in heaven happens just like that. And He could make it happen just like that on earth if He wanted to. The sickness, the loss, the things that you say, why doesn't God do something? He could. But He doesn't act heavy-handed in this. And He gives us that choice between these two kingdoms, the kingdom of Satan and His kingdom. And He talks about us. Give us today our daily bread. We are people that are needful. We're reminded each and every day that we are needful. And forgive us our debts. The whole idea that we can end up getting into debt. That's the easiest thing. Just sign right here. Also, as we also have forgiven our debtors, the way we carry on and interact with each other. And lead us not into temptation. God, I can find it all by myself. You don't need to lead me there. And when He speaks this, He's talking about that we are going to be tempted, but help us and help us acknowledge You and know You and recognize You in the face of temptation so that we don't see how close we can get to that and end up having a problem. But deliver us from the evil one, because the evil one wants us to be delivered into his hands. He delights in lives that are destroyed, marriages that are torn apart. He delights in those things. Deliver us from temptation, or lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from the evil one. And he says, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. And the idea here is you need to become something special, something different. You need to reflect the goodness of God. When you know God and learn of God, you need to end up reflecting that by being a forgiving person like God is a forgiving God. The last thing he'll talk about here, and then I want to wrap it up, is when you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show others they are fasting. They put dust on it. They look. They want everybody to know, oh, they must be fasting. See, they want other people to right away be able to point out and know that they are religious. They must be spiritual because of what they're doing. He said, truly, I tell you, they have received the reward in full. When another person says, oh, they must be real spiritual, they're missing the meal. You know, most of my college, I ended up fasting for a 24-hour period of time. Now, a lot of that, I would say probably a good 90% of it, was not spiritual at all. They would serve at our college a great meal on Sunday afternoon. It was the best, after church, the best meal of the week. Sunday night was like, Monday morning was like, and then Monday by lunchtime, by supper time Monday, you were back on track. And so I just wouldn't eat. Wouldn't eat. And I told, I'm fasting. See my fasting stripe here? When you weigh 20 pounds dripping wet, people, you don't need a fast. Boy, that can change. He said, don't disfigure. When you do that, when you make sure you are in a mode to where other people can tell you've just blown it. You've just received your full reward. There's no more benefit that comes from that. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face. Do what your mom told you to do. Go in there and wash your face. So that it will not be obvious to others that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. The real question is God enough? Am I more content with the God and creator of heaven and earth rewarding me for my efforts? Or do I want to create a fan club? Do I want to create a group of groupies that follow me in? Oh, Ernest T. reminds me of stolen valor. I was reading about that because I was trying to think of sermon titles. And one of them was Stolen Valor. And it has become a real problem. I didn't realize until it has become a very serious and real problem. People that pose in uniforms that they bought somewhere, and they begin telling a story so that people will respect them and honor them. And people defer to them. There are oftentimes, because Gail is obviously the most spiritual one amongst the both of us, she'll say, buy their lunch. Honey, I can't buy my... Buy their lunch. Okay. I'll go to the waitress. Hey, tell those guys or those girls that their lunch is paid for. Okay. It would really tick me off if I knew that instead of buying lunch from some soldier who had been over in Afghanistan or Iraq or somewhere, I was buying it for Gomer Pyle, who had just served on a TV set. But stolen valor is a problem now. And you look at Ernest T. Bass. The whole episode, Ernest T. wants to join the army. At least that's what everybody's thinking. It wouldn't work, Ernest T. Now, you are in the army, you're going to be thrown out. I don't want to join the army. What have we just been doing the last 20 minutes of this episode? What I want me is a uniform. I want a shortcut. I want something for display only. Because Chelsea gets the girls, why can't I get the girls? And all I want is a uniform. All I want is to wear something publicly so everybody can think something. So I can be on full display. But it's obvious. It doesn't matter how he salutes. It doesn't matter how he tries to walk. You see right through that. And Jesus is telling them, look right through that. Look through that religious junk that people are trying to sell you. When you go through basic training or boot camp, I learned that those are two different things. One's for Marines and one's for other people. You know, the other ones are different things. I didn't know that until I was reading about stolen valor. But it changes you. It transforms you. It makes you into a different person. And you stick out. Not because you're trying to put some role. It's because you have been changed and you have been transformed. I met a person to do a transaction over in Norfolk. He was military. And we had to go in different buildings. And every building we went into, just automatically, right as we went to the building, he took his hat off, put it right under his arm. Every one. Just. The other thing he said is, yes, sir. No, sir. Yes, sir. I said, dude, you are so impressing me. I wish I could do that. It transforms you. And Ernest T. Bass wants the shortcut. And Ernest T. Bass is going to go up there with Barney's uniform, and people are going to look at him. And if Jesus is up there saying, don't humor him. Don't humor him. Don't be drawn away because of what others think. Run to your secret place in your giving, in your praying, and in your fasting. And know a God that loves you and died for you and rose again so you can know Him and you can be transformed and you can not be for display only. God, this is for you only. No one else. It's for you only. And He gives a promise. God will. Not saying God might reward you if you do this. God will reward you. And He rewards you in so many ways. In some cultures, they don't teach this. They don't teach. Our culture is seeped in this. They don't teach like giving. It's not in their language. I read a story of a person. He said there was a man drowning. And they yelled at him, give us your hand, give us your hand. In his culture, in his society, everybody wants something from you. You don't give anybody anything. And he wouldn't do it. And he's almost going drowning. And then they said, take my hand, take my hand. And at that, it clicked. Oh, I can take something. And he reaches up and grabs the hand. He almost allowed his culture and what he had been, his mindset on giving to keep him from reaching out. It wasn't until somebody put it in a different language, a different way to take. And we are raising a generation of takers, of not prayers, and of people who, spiritually speaking, that's what fasting does. I meant to say that's what fasting does. Do you realize when you fast, the spirit is telling your flesh what to do? You realize how that's a reverse? Most of the time, it's our flesh that tells our spirit what to do. Jesus would speak this life into the people that heard Him. He would give them hope so that their lives could be transformed, so they could eagerly anticipate a kingdom that was coming and a Savior that loved them. May you and I, in a world of craziness, realize that God's a big enough God to change us and God's a big enough God to reward us. And that really should be enough. Don't be satisfied with displays of religiosity. Let's pray. Father, thank You for Your love. Thank You that You transform us from the inside out. Help us to know You in a way that transforms and changes. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.